and welcome to PowerPoints. This is the official live and online ministry of the Carter Metropolitan CME Church. I'm Pastor T, and I am so excited to worship with you. If you've been watching us since our little program began, you know that I spend a lot of time preaching and teaching about power. God has given us power. We have power to overcome, power to win, power to know, and power to understand. God entrusted us with his power, but if we're honest, if we use it, sometimes we abuse it. And sometimes we even dismiss God's power and the power that God gives us because we're either afraid of it or we don't understand it. Our collective truth this morning is that we need the power of God to work in our lives. So let's worship, pray, and open our hearts to receive a greater understanding of the power that is at work in us.
Let's say it together.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. Say, there is power in the name of Jesus.
Come on.
To break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain.
Yeah.
To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
Let's say it together, there is power.
There is power. There is power in the name of Jesus,
yeah.
To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
Declare and say,
to break every chain, break every chain, break every.
Now somebody lift your hands in the air right here.
See, there's an
Yeah.
Good morning. I'm Minister Nicola King. Will you join me in prayer? Every eye closed, every head bowed. Father God, we approach you as humbly as we know how, giving you thanks and glorifying you, God. For you are worthy, God, and so we thank you. God, we thank you for this morning, allowing us another day, God, to complete the things that you've called us to do. God, we thank you for another day that we get to learn more about you, God, that we get to get closer to you, God. And so we give you thanks for that. God, we thank you for a peaceful night. God, we thank you for a safe night. God, we thank you for a restful night. God, because of that, we were able to get up. You allowed us to come into this new day, to see and do things that we've not seen or done. And so, God, I give you thanks. Now, God, I gather with my brothers and sisters. And although we aren't in physical proximity, God, we are in spiritual proximity. We are on one accord. And your word says that wherever two or three gather, you will be in their midst. And so, God, I know now that you are in living rooms, in bedrooms, in kitchens, God, wherever they can see and hear my voice, you are there. And so we thank you for that. Now, God, we come to ask you for some things because we know that there's no other place that we can go. There's no other place that we need to go. God, we just need to come to you. Your word says, give it all to you, to lay our burdens at your feet. And so, God, now I pray for health, God, for people who are sick, for people with COVID-19, God. I pray recovery over their lives, God. God, I pray that in this pandemic, you will flourish, God, that your healing power will be unleashed over all the people who are sick, God. Because only you can correct what is going on right now. Only you can heal the earth, God. And so we believe that now with all our hearts, with all our souls, with all our faith, God. We know that you are the great healer. God, you created each and every person on the earth. You know us by the hairs on our heads, all the way down to the soles of our feet, God. You know what needs to be fixed in us. And so, God, I pray against diabetes. I pray against high blood pressure. I pray against cancer, God, because you are the great healer, God. And only you can take care of these things. I don't care what the doctors say, God. You have the last say so. And so, God, I ask that you release healing all over the earth, God, in the name of Jesus right now. Father God, I pray over finances. During this pandemic, many have lost their jobs. They are unable to find other jobs, God. And so I ask that you release a financial blessing over everyone that is within the sound of my voice, God. God, I ask that you release financial responsibility along with the financial blessing, God. Help us to better understand, God, how to manage our money. Because if you give it to us, we need to know what to do with it. And so, God, I ask you to release financial responsibility. God, I ask you to look over the people, God, and just bless them. God, I ask you to look over those that might be suffering with mental challenges and mental issues right now. Because we have been enclosed for so many months, some people are suffering. People are afraid, God. People are scared, God. But you did not give us a spirit of fear. And so right now I ask you to release holy boldness over everyone that is within the sound of my voice, over everyone that is listening to this video, God. I ask you to bless them with holy boldness and to stand in their faith. God, I ask you to encourage them, God, to revive them, God, to give them more endurance and more stamina in this, God. Because as you work, God, we need to be patient. We need to wait with expectation, God, because you will cure the earth. You will take care of the pandemic. But we need to be patient and we need to believe. So, God, right now I ask you to just go into homes, God, and touch hearts and minds, God. Encourage, God. Strengthen, God. Revitalize, God. Some of us have gotten tired during the pandemic. And we're wore down, God, but I know that you're able to revive us just with a touch, God, just with your spirit. And so now I ask you to do these things, God, to go into homes, God, and shore us up, God. Be our hedge of protection, God. Keep us safe always. All these things I ask for in the awesome name of your son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning, Carter family. My name is David Valentine II, and this morning I will be leading the responsive reading. The responsive reading will be taken from Acts chapter 12, verses 1 through 16. And I will be reading from the Passion Translation. During this period, King Herod incited persecution against the church, causing great harm to the believers. He even had the apostle Jacob, John's brother, beheaded. When Herod realized how much this pleased the Jewish leaders, he had Peter arrested and thrown into prison during the Feast of Passover. 16 soldiers were assigned to guard him until Herod could bring him to public trial, immediately after the Passover celebrations were over. The church went into a season of intense intercession, asking God to free him. The night before Herod planned to bring him to trial, he made sure that Peter was securely bound with two chains. Peter was sound asleep between two soldiers, with additional guards stationed outside his cell door, when all at once an angel of the Lord appeared, filling his prison cell with a brilliant light. The angel struck Peter on the side to awaken him and said, "Hurry up, let's go." Instantly, the chains fell off his wrists. The angel told him, "Get dressed, put on your sandals, bring your cloak, and follow me." And Peter quickly left the cell and followed the angel, even though he thought it was only a dream or a vision, for it seemed unreal. He couldn't believe it was really happening. They walked unseen past the first guard post and then the second before coming to the iron gate that leads to the city. And the gate swung open all by itself right in front of them. They went out into the city and were walking down a narrow street when all of a sudden the angel disappeared. That's when Peter realized that he wasn't having a dream. He said to himself, "This is really happening. The Lord sent his angel to rescue me from the clutches of Herod and from what the Jewish leaders planned to do to me." When he realized this, he decided to go to the home of Mary and her son, John Mark. The house was filled with people praying. When he knocked on the door to the courtyard, a young servant girl named Rose got up to see who it was. When she recognized Peter's voice, she was so excited that she forgot to open the door, but ran back inside the house to announce Peter is standing outside. "Are you crazy?" they said to her. But when she kept insisting, they answered, "Well, it must be his angel." Meanwhile, Peter was still outside knocking on the door. When they finally opened it, they were shocked to find Peter standing there. The word of God for the people of God. And we all say together, thanks be to God.
And what do we believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate. He was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
On Thursday morning, I woke up around 5:30, only to realize that there was a power outage in my neighborhood. When I logged on to the DTE website, they informed me that there was an outage in my area that had been caused by the wind. I kept on reading, only to learn that they were already working to restore the loss of power, but it was going to take some time. They said that I would have my power back on by 3 p.m. When you lose your power in the middle of a heat wave, several things go through your mind. You think about being uncomfortable. You think about the possibility of losing perishable items. You assess your phone and laptop and tablet to see just how long you will be able to communicate with the outside world, because once your power is out, your ability to communicate becomes limited. Thursday, my power went out, and it wasn't my fault. Thursday, my power went out and the power company said that the wind was the cause of my power issue. Sometimes in our lives as believers, we experience a spiritual power outage. Sometimes it happens without warning. Sometimes it happens as a result of our own purposeful disconnection. Sometimes it happens because we've been left exposed. The first thing I want you to know today is that God has given us power, and God's power never runs out. Storms and issues and winds and sickness may all blow in your direction to attempt to affect you, but they cannot corrupt or destroy the power of God that's in you. If you've got power, you've got access to that power no matter what happens to you. If you've got power, you've got access to that power when it seems like all of your options are limited. When I'm weak, that's when I'm strong. Matter of fact, God's strength is made perfect in my weakness. We do many things to prepare for a potential loss of power in the natural. Listen, it's interesting that most of our preparation points us in the direction of things that help us stay connected to power. See, so that we can navigate through darkness, we keep candles and batteries for our flashlights. So that we can know what's going on and have the ability to communicate, we make sure that our cell phones and tablets and laptops are charged up and ready to go. Maybe, just maybe, we don't prepare for our spiritual outages the same way that we prepare for our natural ones. When we have a spiritual power outage, watch this, our effectiveness in prayer, our profession of faith, our victory over obstacles and enemies is in jeopardy because we haven't prepared for the potential loss of power. I can preach and teach that you have power. I can point you in the direction of the power. I can even demonstrate the power that's at work within me. But if you don't believe in the power for yourself, if you don't access the power for yourself, when the outage comes, you will wait for restoration to come in frustration. You'll be anxious. You'll feel helpless. You'll allow fear to take over. Some of us have power, but we don't want the responsibility that comes with the power. We want power, but we don't want to submit ourselves to prayer. We don't want to submit ourselves to instructions. We don't want to submit ourselves to discipline and focus. And so we think that the Christian experience becomes about doing good deeds and showing up to a place once a week and not walking in the fullness of the power that God has released into your life. We cannot forsake the power that we have to bind up brokenness and loose blessing. We cannot forsake the power that we have to lay hands on the sick and watch them recover. We cannot underestimate the power that we have to speak and shift our circumstances. Y'all, we have power. It's not a power that comes with denomination. It's not a power that comes with ordination, but we have power that comes with our connection to Jesus Christ. Our power comes from his name. Our power comes from his word. Our power flows through his spirit. Before we get into the scripture lesson today, listen, I want to just introduce two words into your spiritual vocabulary. The first word is intention. Intention is a purpose or objective. That's very important. Intention is the driving force behind your words and your actions. The next word is means. Means is an action or a method that births
a result. Okay, so let's put this together for practical consumption. Let's say that we need groceries. In order for us to do our shopping, we need a means of transportation. So for the sake of this illustration, a car will be our means. The car is going to take us to the store, but the car cannot operate by itself. The car cannot navigate the road by itself. In order for the car to get us to the store, we have to insert and apply our intention. Watch this. We have to get into the car. We have to operate it responsibly. We have to stop it when it needs to stop. We have to turn it when it needs to turn so that we can end up in the right place, so that we can end up at our goal. Watch this. Far too often, we as believers think that the power is in the means when it's really in the intention. Oh, don't miss this. Don't miss this. We say that prayer has power. We say that reading the word will give you power. But if your heart is not in the prayer, if your faith is not aligned with the prayer, if you don't understand what you're reading in the scripture, then the prayer can't avail and the scripture will leave you empty. Some of us still trying to walk in the power of a now I lay me down to sleep level prayer. Some of us are trying to accomplish ministry in the power of an I read the Sunday school lesson last week, so I'll be good level of study. But our prayers will never have power, and our worship will never have power, and our faith will never have power if we do not apply our intention. We have to want to see God's power manifest. We have to want to know the mind of God. We have to believe that power is available to us on an individual level to advance our purpose, as well as on a corporate level to advance the kingdom of God. Let's turn to the word for some answers this morning. The scripture was already read in your hearing today, but allow me to highlight a few verses for your observation. Acts chapter 12, beginning at verse 1, reads like this. During this period, King Herod incited persecution against the church, causing great harm to believers. He even had the apostle Jacob, John's brother, beheaded. When Herod realized how much this pleased the Jewish leaders, he had Peter arrested and thrown in prison during the feast of Passover. 16 soldiers were assigned to guard him until Herod could bring him to public trial immediately after the Passover celebrations were over. The church went into a season of intense intercession, asking God to free him. And then dropping down to the 12th verse. When he did this, he decided to go to the home of Mary and her son, John Mark. The house was filled with people praying. Now that we've heard the story, let's look for intention and means. We learned that King Herod, a person who is in a definite position of power, has decided to persecute the church. Ain't nothing new under the sun. Scripture says that believers were harmed. They were discouraged. They were probably arrested unfairly. They were probably refused opportunities and resources simply because of who and what they believed. We learned in the text that as a way of building an alliance with the Jewish leaders, he had an influential person in the faith community killed. Since Herod was on a roll, he decides to target Peter, one of the leaders of the church. Peter, who was known to preach and teach and work miracles among the people, Herod decides to place Peter in jail. Not during a regular weekday, but Herod throws Peter in jail during Passover, a time when the church was committed to fellowship and prayer. Herod was familiar with the religious traditions of the day. He knew that the people would be assuming positions of prayer, but Herod did not anticipate those prayers to have any power. Herod did not think that those prayers would have power to affect his power. Your Bible says that Herod puts Peter in jail, and to show everybody how powerful he was, he assigned 16 guards to Peter. When he was in jail, Peter had to sleep between two soldiers. He placed guards at the entrance of the cell. Don't miss this. Herod had to use all the power that he had because he realized that Peter was working with some power of his own. Herod did not discount the power of the church because he heard about the great demonstrations of power that occurred when they all got together and on one accord. This says to me that Peter walked in a kind of power that was not hidden. Peter operated in a power that had been verified. The people who called themselves believers were growing in that same kind of power. So that meant they were a threat to the powers that were in place for personal gain. Some folks wonder why you have such influence. They wonder why you can make things happen. They wonder why people work so well with you, because in their eyes, you're just a nobody. You don't have the kind of power that they have. You don't come from the kind of family that they came from. Some folks don't understand that power belongs to God. Power comes from God, and God gives real power to the people who have his heart. God gives real authority to the people who want him to have his way. God gives power to the ones who want to see his power made manifest. And y'all, those are not always the people who have a title. The kings and religious leaders realized that there were some limitations to their power, but here were these believers. Here were these followers of Christ. Here were these broke people who were coming together to pool their resources so that their needs were met. Here were these illiterate people who were walking around with an understanding of scriptures that had been written on their hearts. Here were these commoners, these regular people who walked around in boldness and power. They did not live in palaces. They were not considered important by secular standards, but they spoke with, thought with, prayed with, and lived with power. Watch this. When the church saw what Herod was doing to believers, they could have decided to go underground. They could have decided that walking in power was too costly. They could have decided that the power that God had given them was too dangerous. When Peter got arrested, they could have said, "No, sir, you're on your own." They could have acted like they were powerless in a season of violence and persecution and trauma. Herod thought that he was engineering a power outage for the believers. Herod assumed that if he weakened them with persecution, if he tired them out with assassinations and threats, if he weakened them with bullying tactics, then they would accept their powerless nature. My God, Herod didn't expect the believers in the text to be prepared. He didn't expect the believers in the text to have a plan. Herod didn't expect a prayer to have any power. Herod didn't expect the people to connect their intention with their means. Watch this. The goal in the text was to get Peter out of jail so that he would not have to stand trial and potentially be executed for treason. The goal in the text was to make sure that the believers took a stand in the midst of oppression and discrimination. The means to accomplishing their goal was prayer. Prayer was the vehicle the believers relied on to help stay empowered in the midst of a season of uncertainty. But empty prayer by itself would have left Peter in prison and the people in oppression. They had to add faith to their prayer. They had to add confidence to their prayer. They had to connect their understanding of who God is and how God operates to their prayer. They had to bring their determination to see God's power released to their prayer. Y'all, they didn't just pray. Verse 5 of the text says that the church went into a season of intense intercession, asking God to free Peter. Intercession is an act of intervening on behalf of another person. Romans 8:26 says that we don't know what to pray, but the Spirit intercedes for us in our weakness. Romans 8:34 said Jesus is on the right hand of God the Father right now interceding for us. God the Son and God the Holy Spirit intercede for us. They go to God on our behalf have to plead our case, to ensure our victory, and to secure our power. If we find ourselves experiencing a spiritual power outage, all we have to do is realize that Jesus and Holy Spirit are interceding for us that we might regain access to power. When the winds of doubt and when the winds of indifference, when the winds and storms of life attempt to limit or disconnect our power, all we have to do is remember that a resource may have been cut off, but we are still connected to the source. The believers did not just pray in the beginning of the text, but when Peter gets to the house, Peter finds them there still in prayer. Maybe we struggle with prayer because we don't know how to fill up our prayers with power. Maybe we struggle with prayer because we don't realize that when we go before the throne of grace, that we are in direct proximity to our miracle and breakthrough. You already know that power-filled prayer got Peter out of his chains and took him out of jail undetected. And Peter thought he was seeing a vision, but power-filled prayer directed an angel to escort him out of harm's way and back into the safety of fellow believers. I ask myself, why would this passage of scripture not speak to Peter's prayers and Peter's power? And God spoke to my spirit and said Peter was in jail because he was guilty of walking in his power. But Peter being in jail didn't mean that he didn't have power or authority. Peter could be in jail, comfortable and sleeping deeply enough to have to be shocked into consciousness, because when you've got power, you have no reason to be pressed. My God, when you've got power, it can be a attacked by outside elements, but it will always be restored by an inside source. The passage didn't speak much about Peter's power because the people, the believers, tapped in to their power. They didn't dismiss it. They didn't ignore it. They didn't devalue it. They just walked in it. In the midst of an apparent outage, they still had power. What about you? It's not enough to go through the motions of prayer or praise or worship or even belief. Now is the time to reconnect to your power source. Now is the time to apply your intention to your means. If you can hear the winds, if you can see the thunder, if you can feel something is heading in your direction, listen, it's time for you to prepare. If the outage happens, you need to be able to access some power as quickly as possible. You can charge your phone and your tablet, but are you charged up with faith? Are you charged up with intention? Do you know that no matter how dark it gets, you still have power because Jesus is the light of the world? Are you charged up with the intention that no matter who stops talking to you, you still have power because you can converse with the creator and the sustainer of the universe? You've got power, you've got means, but do you have intention? So, Father, we've been frustrated because there's been an outage in our power for so long. We've been struggling because we've been trying to pray without intention. And God, we ask that you would remind us that it doesn't matter what happens to us, because greater is he who is in us. And so God, I ask that you would begin moving by your power and might in every life that is connected to this broadcast. I ask you, God, that you would restore our access to power. I ask you, God, that you would help us to prepare and plan so that when the next stormy wind blows in our direction, we will not be moved. God, we thank you for giving us power. We thank you for helping us to recognize our need of your power. God, you can trust us with your power. You can trust us with your power. You can trust us to use your power in the right way. You can trust us to be the kind of people. You can trust us to be the kind of church that represents your power. We will no longer be satisfied with going through the motions. We will no longer assign more responsibility to the means. But even now, our hearts are filling up with intention. Now we want your will. Now we trust your word. Now we know that all things are possible because of your power at work within us. Thank you for your power, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for joining us for PowerPoints with Pastor T. We hope that you were blessed by your experience in worship today. Once our restrictive measures have been lifted, if you're ever in the Motor City, we would love for you to join us. We would certainly like to thank God for our worship leaders who led us so mightily in worship today. Don't forget to join us for our virtual Sunday school next Sunday morning at 10 a.m. If you'd like the link, please feel free to email us at powerpoints1510@gmail.com. You can also send your prayer request there too. Also, once worship has ended, don't forget to pass the peace. Until next time, know that God is able and impossible is nothing. Now, I hope that you are ready for the benediction. I want you to look me in my face and hear me when I say that it's my prayer to God for you that the Lord will bless you and keep you, that the Lord will make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you, that the Lord would lift up the light of his countenance upon all of you and give you peace. That's the way Bishop would do it. Here's what I'm going to say. I pray that you would desire to see the power of God in every area of your life. I pray that you would connect your intention with your means. I pray that you would remember that even in the midst of a power outage, that you still are connected to the power source. Now, unto him who's able to do exceeding and abundantly above all that we could ask or think, be glory, honor, majesty, dominion, and power now, henceforth, and forevermore. And all God's people said amen and amen. Go in peace and remember, you've got power.